What's up, everyone, and welcome down to another episode of Zetro's Toxic Vault. And my guest today is the drummer for a band called Dress the Dead. But there's so much more that he has done that we are going to talk about right now. So put your seatbelts on, people. I'm talking about Mark the Shark Hernandez.
Oh, wow.
What's up, here, Zach? You are.
It's great to be here. Thank
Finally,
you.
Good to get you in. Finally, good to get your story in. Because you have such a long history with so many of us. I've never really done a project with you, but right. I mean, 6 degrees of separation. You've done a project with everybody I've done with a project with. So
I know. I think I've been in every like major Bay Area band except for.
Did you do it? You haven't done an Exodus stint, though.
I haven't done an Exodus stint and Death Angel.
That's the only two, huh?
Yeah.
We're definitely going to talk about that. Yeah, Mark has got a long history. If you guys are going, yeah, it kind of looks familiar. Played in Violence,
yeah.
Kind of towards the end of the
yes.
first run, right? Yeah. So what year would have that been? 92?
That would have been 92.
93.
I just graduated high school.
Wow. So yeah, we're gonna do like we always do on the Vault. We're gonna go chronologically with Mark. We're gonna start where it always starts. Growing up. Where did it hit you? Where did you get it? Where was it? Where did you grow up?
Well, I grew up in, I was born in Concord, California. My dad's full-blooded Mexican and my mom's Irish English.
Wow.
So, I know, I was destined to be a drunk.
Damn.
But, you know, on my dad's side, as far back as I can remember, you know, the parties were, there were hundreds of us, you know what I mean? And everybody played a musical instrument. So, I think it's just in my DNA, man.
Traditional Mexican type music, or
yeah,
was it
everything,
or just anything?
You know, and one of my great aunts was like a drummer in Vegas on the circuit, you know, which was pretty awesome. My great aunt Gloria, you know, in my immediate family, I'm the only one. But
so your mom and dad never really took on them,
and they never pushed it. You know, it was just always kind of my thing. You know, my uncle, my dad's brother. The thing is, when I was really really young, he would buy me stuff to try to annoy my dad. And so, you know, he bought me a pogo stick. He bought me, he actually bought me my first drum. And it was to upset my dad. But I beat that thing relentless.
Just a drum.
Just a little drum for my little,
not even like
little
a
kid
snare,
chair.
Like a snare
just
drum?
You know, just to
How
make
old?
Noise. I was still in a baby chair, you know.
So, really?
Yeah, so we're talking like from that long. I mean, I got my first drum set when I was 5. So that's
okay.
Really
yeah,
where
yeah, that's then. But that really, that's young. I mean, that is
it
young.
Is.
I mean,
yeah.
I mean, I've, you know, you hear musicians, oh, I started at 8 or 9, or some great players start at 12 or 13, you know. You
yeah, get, yeah. Start,
but 5 is, I mean, you know, you're not even kindergarten yet, man. You're already playing music. What was the first type of music that grabbed your ear? Was it actually the music that you played at the parties that your parents had played for you? Or did you have a heavy ear at 5 years old?
Yeah, that kind of developed. You know, believe it or not, I was into like the Gap Band and Rick James.
Which is all cool shit.
Great shit, man. I mean,
great shit. There's not a metalhead in the world that will say that shit sucks. I'm sorry. It's that funky, bangy attitude.
Well, and I think for me that helped to develop my sense of a groove, because I think that's part of my style, is having a groove. Because if you could shake your ass to heavy metal music, it's the drummer, you know what I mean?
Sure.
And so there's part of that I think really took to me. But you know, I mean, my dad listened to Jim Croce, who's still one of my favorite artists.
Me,
you know,
too.
His storytelling is
yes.
amazing.
Yes.
You know, and even my kids, you know, I feel like I did something right, because that's part of their playlist, you know. My mom was country, you know, so it was, you know, like Loretta Lynn, Willie Nelson,
sure.
You know, Outlaw
my
Country.
Waylon, so, yeah.
It was great stuff. So I had a mix of all that, not really traditional like Mexican music, because I didn't really have a traditional Mexican culture growing up, you know. When my dad came, we'll go back to my grandparents. When they first came to California, I mean, it was back when, you know, owning your culture and even being Mexican was not in vogue. You know what I mean? They were here to assimilate. So in my dad's household, that's why, consequently, I don't speak Spanish, you know. But it was to assimilate. So in the house, it was you speak English and you become like everybody else.
But that was the time, because
yeah.
I'm from Portuguese descent and my grandparents also came here from Portugal, and my parents did not speak Portuguese. because they looked down on that. They wanted them to be so Americanized that now it's a double-edged sword. I mean, now it would be so, it's so beneficial to speak two languages, but in the 40s and 50s, my dad would explain to me, I go, how come I would go into my grandfather's house and they would speak Portuguese, right? Probably speak
Spanish in my grandparents' house, yeah.
But when we went home, then I go, well, how come you never learned it? He says, because they didn't want us to learn it. So was it the same? Did your parents explain it the same way that they wanted?
We just didn't. I mean, I, for all intents and purposes, I grew up in suburbia. You know what I mean?
So did I. I did too.
Never left.
Dublin, California. I'm still here. The vault is in Dublin, California. Suburbia. I was born in Oakland, but...
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, I mean, in Martinez. So we grew up there.
Right.
And, you know, my mom being being white, that's just... That's the way it was, you know, went to Catholic school and assimilated, you know, for all intents and purposes. I'm light skinned, man. You know, people don't even know I'm Hispanic.
Mark Hernandez.
I know. That's about it. I got the surname, right?
Listen, there had to be one in the woodpile somewhere, right? That's terrible. So you're five and your new drum and your first kit.
Yeah.
And what type of music are you? Are you Rick James? That's the type of stuff that you're playing?
Well, or? We had a neighbor move in across the street. So the way I came upon getting a drum set was, you remember the JCPenney catalog?
Of course. Every Christmas
I'd fucking that. My sister and I would sit there in front of the TV and just circle everything we wanted.
Totally. That circle and things. Me and my brother did the same thing.
And it was like, oh, I gotta have this
back now, bro.
Totally. And so I circled. There was this Buddy Rich Rhythm Pro drum set, right? And it was all plastic and it was like clear and red striped. And I still have it. It's still in a storage shed that my mom has. And, you know, I mean, it was all intents and purposes, it's a toy drum set. But I really, really wanted this thing. So my parents, you know, kind of like, what the hell, you know, get it to him and get it out of his system. You know, but that, I mean, I beat the shit out of that thing for hours every day. That's all I did, you know. And
those things couldn't take too much of a...
Oh no!
Heads were like,
dude. The plastic like, heads are yeah, like this exactly. now. You
I
know,
mean, they're like, you know, because my brother had one. I don't know, 68 or 69. My parents bought him. I remember it to this day. It had like far out on it or something like that. But that you could only play it.
Yeah, and these were actually plastic heads, right?
Really?
So it was great. So I circled that in the catalog, and you know, Santa Claus gave it to me for Christmas, you know. And at that time, we had a neighbor that had moved in next door that was a cousin of the Picos, who were our next door neighbors. And he was, you know, long hair. He was a rocker guy. And he had turned me on to like Iron Maiden.
What year is this, Mark?
We're talking like 82.
82. And so you're 10?
I'm kind of... Well, yeah, let me go back because I've already skipped a little bit.
Yeah, you can't skip.
So, No. So we had these friends, too, that my parents used to go over and hang out and party with on the weekends. And they were into Kiss. So that's really my first introduction to it. The thing that grabbed me and said, this is...
And you're how old?
I'm five.
You're five.
Yeah, I know.
Kiss.
Yeah, so around five, six, for my birthday, these people give me... double platinum.
Wow.
Right? I know. And you look back and you think, that's how inappropriate is that? But dude,
it's so appropriate.
It's so appropriate, right? I mean, for guys like us, that was it. And from that point on, man, it was like everything about that band, that music, that lifestyle was like, it just struck me. It really just struck me. And so it was like every day before, you know, preschool and kindergarten, I would be playing that record on the record player, just sitting in front of it, listening to it. So when I got that drum set, you know, I mean, I wanted to be Peter Criss.
So you were, that was my next question.
Totally.
Were you your first, I was Peter Criss, is that what you were your first?
Yeah, totally. Totally.
Peter Criss first, amazing.
So, you know, I would sit there with headphones on and just, you know, thinking I was Peter Criss, but dude, it was just racket, full on racket. But my parents, you know, they gave me that space to do it. God bless them, man. You know,
wow,
I know,
awesome.
It's fantastic. And so that's what really, really brought me in. You know, it would be a few years later to where my parents figured out that, well, this isn't just a fad.
Right.
You know, he's really into this. And like I said, they didn't push me. They just let it be. And if it's going to foster or if it's going to flame out. And so I finally got, you know, like a real drum set one year.
About how old?
I was probably about 8 or 9. Yeah.
And what was your first real drum set?
Well, it was a, my dad, you know, wanted to get me a drum set, and he was, you know, as a parent now, I look back and I think, what a fucking shithead kid I was, right? In my mind, you know what I mean? Because now we're going into the 80s a little bit, you know what I mean? So I'm, like I said, eight or nine. And, you know, like, there's Kiss, there's Iron Maiden, there's, what was the other big one? You know, the drum set I had in my mind I was asking for was fucking Frankie Benali's drum set from Metal Health. That was just like gigantic. Wow. You know what I mean? This is, my parents know this is exactly what I want. You know what I mean? And so what I did is I got, I believe it was an old Ludwig set that my dad had spent hours like recovering in like a black abalone, you know, and it was a single kick, two toms and a floor, you know, and a snare drum. And, you know, when I got it, I was kind of like, oh man, you know, I couldn't understand why Santa Claus brought me a used drum set. Like, what did I do wrong? You know what I mean? And years later, knowing that, you know, as a parent, oh my God, that must have crushed my dad. You know what I mean? He put all this love and care into it. And here I was like, oh man, really?
This is what Santa Claus does?
Totally. This is what he thinks of me?
Really? Not even in the boxes, dude? Somebody else. What, one of the elves playing this fucking thing before he brought it out? You know what I mean? What the fuck?
Totally.
Oh my.
I know, man. And so, but that didn't slow me down. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, so I got a drum set, so we play, you know, and we continue on, you know, it was great. They gave me a room in the house to put my drum set in. It was kind of like my room, you know, and still every day, you know, I go to school, I come home, and I would just play until it got dark.
Uh-huh.
And that's what I did, you know? So.
Now, first band, do you remember? No. Let me ask you one other question. Did you ever have to do lessons? Because I know you're kind of self-taught yourself. Did you ever take lessons?
I kind of did because, as I said, I went to Catholic school, you know, because one of the things with my pops was that, you know, he's a self-made blue-collar businessman. He's done very well for himself, you know? And so in town, going to the Catholic school, that was like the private school, right? So that was, I don't want to say a status symbol, but it kind of
sure
was.
Sure it is, because you have to pay for that.
Yeah, it's your not, kids go to private school.
In our era,
school.
That was a big thing.
Yeah, for exactly.
Why do you pay for school when you can go to public school, right?
Yeah, so I started going, like in first grade, you know, one of the nuns would teach me, you know, like basic rudiments. But
So the nun could go.
Absolutely. And, you know, I was a bit of a problem child, might I add in there, you know what I mean? Bit of a ADD would be how it would be diagnosed today, but.
Welcome to children. Sorry, you know you have children.
Totally.
I have children.
Totally.
Everybody has ADD.
Could you imagine having all these devices in our era?
Oh, my God.
Oh, shit.
I mean, I had to go. We had to go to find a dime to make a phone call if you were late at home, and you had to find a phone. Remember that?
Yes, I do.
Oh my!
Now yes,
you
I do.
Do not do that. Now you just go flip, flip, blank,
bang. Yeah, yeah.
You know, so.
Oh, I got an Uber coming first.
No, I'm ordering you an Uber, son. Stay right there. Where are you at? You know what I mean? That's how it works now.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
So, you know, I continued. I did that through first grade, and it wasn't until I actually got into public school, which was around sixth grade, because I was having issues at the Catholic school, you know.
At Our Lady of 151st Street.
St. Catherine's of Siena.
At Our Lady of St. Catherine's Siena. Yeah. Oh, that. Because the nuns are such sweethearts, you know what I mean?
And mind you, you know, like back in our time too, we were different, right? Like I had to wear a uniform, but I looked like Eddie Munster.
Right.
You know what I mean? And my choice of music.
I love your Eddie Munster hair, by the way. I do miss it. I know you're happy. We've talked about this.
Yeah. And so, you know, it was different. And I don't think they really, in that environment, they didn't foster your individual.
Of course not.
You know, it was like, you be like everybody else. Sure. You're different. We don't want to deal with you, you know? So once I got into public school, though, it was like.
Right.
You know.
Individualism everywhere.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. So I could wear, you know, like my Scorpion shirts and my Judas Priest shirts and have my big bushy hair and my tennis shoes. Yeah, totally. You know what I mean? I could finally, I could express who I was, you know, instead of wearing blue cords and a white shirt and a little red vest.
So sixth grade was the time you hit public school by then.
Yeah. And, you know, thank God for the private school education, because when I got to sixth grade, I was bored because the education I had received up till then was far superior to,
of course,
to the public. I mean, of and course. That's not that's different than it is right. right now, too.
Sure, it is. Of course, it's the same thing. Yeah. It's kind of like the curve, and the curve is slow. And so they have to follow the mule instead of follow the rabbit who's running for it. You know, it's kind of how they have to foster it. Talk about your the first band. And the first time you provoked, I mean, and that could be garage band, that could be playing at the eighth grade fucking talent show. It doesn't matter. Yeah. Talk about that.
My first band ever was when I finally found this guy, Rob, ended up being my best friend through middle school and through high school. And, you know, he got a guitar and he was into guitar. He actually, his first fucking guitar was a Gibson Explorer. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? Because Metallica was becoming a big thing. In 86, I mean, you had Master of Puppets, right? And everybody was like...
Everybody was.
Everybody. That was like, holy shit. Yeah. What just happened? So he had his Gibson Explorer. And by this time, I had already gone on to another drum set, a double bass drum set, you know? And so we formed a band... And I believe the first name we had was Crimson Death.
Wow. Isn't that a movie?
Right? It could be.
I think it's a Boris Karloff movie, Crimson Death.
Could be.
No, the Crimson Cult. The Crimson
Cult. There you go. Okay.
Crimson Cult. But I like that.
Yeah. And, you know, we just played whatever we thought was cool. You know, we were listening to, at that time too, also, you know, coming up, you know, through 86 through 88, you had like Cryptic Slaughter. You know, I started to get into the Angry Samoans.
Sure. Good punk stuff.
Yeah, different punk music.
Great punk stuff.
And so that kind of influenced us as well, you know. So we were kind of immature musically, but, you know, kind of melded it all together. There'd be like some really fast stuff. And at this time, you know, my double bass would, you know, be struggling.
Really?
You know? Yeah. So you're trying. But by the time you get to like verse two, you're like, pop, 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 pop.
One leg's going faster than the other one's not even hitting it.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. It's like a bad mix.
Exactly. Oh, well. Well, that's changed since then, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah, man. You know, but my, you know, going back to my neighbor, too, what he really introduced me to, because the first record I actually ever bought was The Number of the Beast. Like with my own money, I saved it up. And this was like, that kind of changed the game for me, big time.
Clyde Burrows, great.
Had a great swing, dude.
Whoa, boy, did he have a good swing.
You know, and
he didn't play in the league a long time, but boy, when he was in the league, he was hitting home runs left and right, man.
Big time. And that
to
right
this
hand.
Day we talk, oh, I know. To this day, people still talk about the first two records are just monumental because of Clyde Burr.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I mean, who starts songs off like that? Drake, he was the guy that could do it.
And then in it.
Oh, yeah, totally. His yeah.
And that's total punk, yeah, you know totally, what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. I think early Maiden definitely had some punk overtones to those first two records, definitely.
Oh, big time. And Paul Di'Anno.
Yeah, of course, love Paul. Yeah. Right, yeah, definitely fit. Definitely fit. So, first gig.
First gig was the eighth grade talent show.
I love that. I love, believe me, I knew this. I love, everybody comes on here and they're like, it's like, I figured it out by eighth grade. This is what I want to be in. And I'm going to show everybody, right?
And it changed my whole landscape.
Really?
Totally. I was kind of like the outcast, you know, weirdo guy. Because I would wear tight jeans. I would, you know, my mom, God bless her, man. You know, she like really supported me in being who I was. My dad was kind of like not so much happy about, you know, the long hair. My dad was also a politician. And that's great. You know, I mean, he loved the kid I was. But my look, you know, I mean, it was different, bro, you know. So my mom would take me to a seamstress and have my jeans tapered, you know, I could barely get my fucking foot through the jean hole at the bottom, you know. And so it changed. I was kind of like one of like three or four kids at school that wore tight jeans and, you know, tennis shoes with big tongues. And yeah, that was
never
it.
Tied the shoes.
Dude, that was the look.
Tucked them in.
Totally.
Yeah, that's the look.
That was the look. And so, you know, like I said, my buddy Rob and I, we had put this band together. And so we decided we would, let's go for it, man. Two-piece. Just guitar and drums, dude.
I love guitar and drums. I don't get no more wrong than that.
No, it's like White Stripes, right, in eighth grade.
Okay, why not, right? It worked for them.
And we worked out this whole piece, you know, and there was a guitar solo Uh-oh.
I got toys dropping.
So we worked out a whole thing, and then there was a guitar solo, and then there was a drum solo, you know, and quads were a big part of it. You know what I mean? Because, dude, I'm over the mountain, all that, quads were like, oh, that is like godly. Yeah, and then, you know, needless to say, I was introduced to Anvil on Metal on Metal, and it was like Rob Reiner was like, bang, you know what I mean?
Great record.
Oh, my God. It was, and if someone says that they aren't influenced by that, they're fucking lying, man. Yeah. You know?
That's a great record.
That's deep reach. I seen
him on tour Motorhead that year when that came out. I think 83 or maybe 82, early.
Big one, dude.
Early.
Dink, dink, yeah, dink, totally. Dink, you know? And so it was like at that point, man, it was this feeling. You do the drum solo, you know, and then it's like this whole auditorium erupts, right? And you're like, you know, I get goosebumps still thinking about it, because it's like, you know, it's like that first hit, that first time. Yeah.
And then Monday at school, everybody's like, hey, Mark, hey, Mark. I mean, everybody totally. In the world fucking, hey, Mark, hey, what are you doing after that? I'm by lunch. You know,
Wow. Yeah, totally. It was
the
all
power of.
It was. And it was this huge, it was this big thing. It's like all of a sudden, you know, like, whoa, I can do something that not everybody can. I'm not a jock. You know what I mean? I'm fairly intelligent, but like I didn't spend a lot of time.
You got a skill that nobody does.
Right.
And
I've worked at it. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Like, and from you can tell.
From being an outcast to being like, I'll just say mainstream. You know what I mean? It's like now all of a sudden I was hanging out with the popular kids. And it was like, my head's blown up.
How many chicks did you pull because of this performance?
Totally.
And I want to know
how many
girls came up to you on Monday and said, hi, Mark.
Yeah, right. I know.
That's
all of a sudden.
I want to be with him.
It was the hottest cheerleader in school. Yeah, right. I mean, it was like, I didn't even know how to respond, you know? And I do remember this, my dad telling me, you know, if you're good, you don't have to brag. People will brag for you.
It's the truth.
And also, you know, I'll let you know when your head's getting too big.
So Pops is there to check you, huh?
Yeah, totally. And thank God for that, man. Because, you know, man, that. It's intoxicating.
It's and I'll be the first to say, when I first got in, when it first was bestowed on me, I probably was, for the first couple of years, a little bit.
Oh yeah. Know,
tonicked by it, totally.
You're like Jack in the Box, right?
Wow.
Like those shoulders can't hold that head.
I did this. You know what I mean? Go fuck yourself. You know. And then the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. And so you learn and you get older and you learn that, you know, so much more now. I appreciate it. I'm sure you do feel the same way. It's so much more appreciated now. So I understand that mentality. But yeah, I think that is a phase that everybody kind of goes through for a minute. It's like, yeah, I am cool.
I fucking rock.
You look in the mirror and go, I rock.
Yeah.
I rock. You know what I mean? It's like, step back, Junior. You know what I mean? You haven't even conquered the world yet. And everybody finds that out.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, the Lord giveth, like you said, and the Lord taketh away. And I'll tell you, in my history, man, that's happened so many times. Like you said, I truly appreciate it today. Like, to my core, it is a gift, and it'll go like that.
Amen. And I know this because, you know, this is the third time I've been in the band, so I've seen it happen twice before, and it does, and it can happen to anyone.
Yeah.
And I try to tell people that all the time. Just don't get too full of your ducks in you just never know.
Yeah.
Talk about your first real con. I'm not saying that wasn't your first real gig, but with a band where you were bass player, drummer, and you guys were in, did we take that farther? Did you guys go get a bass player? And
we did. Actually, we talked some guy, a high schooler, a guy in high school, to buy a bass. Who was our guitar player's neighbor. Like, yeah, you should play bass, man.
See all the run I got after that gig? Just roll over me. Go buy yourself a bass, right? Was that the talk, dude?
Yeah, totally. He was a skater guy, you know, and it was like,
you got the look, right?
So, you're already skater, got it, dude. Yeah, totally. And so he got a bass. Punk. And, you know, those were the days, you know, we had a boombox. And I'll tell you what, still to this day, they make some of the best recordings. The most audible shit, you know, that you can get on these little condenser mics in these boomboxes.
I had Scott Holderby from Mordred in last week, and we were talking about, you know, the Legacy lyrics were all written from a practice boombox tape at rehearsal. not anything that we do now. It's all, I'll send you the digital file. Yeah. Here. You know what I mean? And you get that, and then turn the drums up. You know, it's like, I had to, okay, go. All right, Eric, start song. You know, you can hear me talking. You know, it's like, but the best.
Yes, absolutely.
I would, because it was easier. I could take the boombox to the rehearsal studio, push play and record, and I had it right there. I didn't have to wait for, can you put that down on a disc, or can you jet that down on a file and send none? It's all done. In 30 seconds, I can go write this song now. I don't have to wait for it to be all... I love that. I miss that.
Me too.
Someone bring the boombox back, please. You guys brought back the fucking the turntable, and look how big it is. Bring the boombox back.
I agree. So we got this bass player, and that carried on. But what happened in the meantime, as you know, glam took over, right? And I make no bones about it. I fucking love glam rock. I'm all about it. Hair metal.
I love hair metal,
fucking,
too.
I don't care. I love Motley Crue. I love Rat.
So do I.
Big. Huge.
Wasp.
Dude, one of my favorites.
Dokken.
Oh, yeah.
Come on. I know. I'm sorry. I do, too. I've told the fans this many times. If I like anything heavy, I don't care. It's still heavy.
Yeah.
Still got edge to it. I'd rather listen to that than fucking Kanye West or anything like that. So kiss my ass, you know?
And let's be honest. Like, glam rock was pop. With guitars.
With heavy guitar.
That's all it is.
And we were pop kids from a pop era. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I grew up with the Osmonds and the Jackson 5, so I know the DeFranco family, right? So
glam took over. And what happened with us is that in the meantime, I went on to school, jazz band in high school, jazz band and symphonic band. And that was the deal. If you want to be in the jazz band, you got to be in the symphonic band, right? I didn't have any interest in symphonic band, but I liked playing the trap. And so what was great about that, though, is it broadened my musical knowledge. I ended up getting an instructor, a drum teacher, who I got to tell you, I thank Jeff Campitelli for completely just blowing up my drum vocabulary as well as music vocabulary.
Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah.
Look what you made.
And for people who don't know, if you don't know, he was the drummer for the Squares, Joe Satriani. Not only is he an amazing drummer, but he's an amazing teacher. And sometimes
the Squares
was
Joe Satriani. Remember before anybody knew who Joe was, he was in the Squares.
Yeah, absolutely.
Early and they Berkeley were like days. Yeah, sure.
They were like the precursor to like bands like Green Day and
They were. You'd see them at tiny little places in Berkeley. I remember that early 81, 82, 83 area. Yeah.
And so he was teaching out of this place in Concord called Spitzer's Music.
I remember.
Right?
Come on.
It's El Rancho now, right?
No way.
Yeah, it's a Mexican dance club and restaurant. But so I started getting lessons from him,
from Spitzer's. Just said Spitzer's. It's like,
oh man, God. I love that place.
Leo's. I mean, you know what I mean? Come on. These are all the places.
Yeah, absolutely. And so. At that point, you know, like I said, glam took over, and then Bon Jovi, which I like Bon Jovi, but that wasn't my cup of tea.
He was as edgy as the other
exactly.
guys were.
But the guitar player was leaning more that way, and I was going Slayer, Venom, Metallica. You know, I was getting heavier, and that's what I wanted to do. So it was kind of a...
So around 84, 85, because, I mean, hair metal was...
Oh, dude, it was king.
87 was just like...
Yeah. Absolutely.
And then 87, 88, 89, bands like us and Anthrax and Megadeth, we started getting run, you know. Metallica was now one of the biggest bands, or becoming one of the biggest bands in the world. So people were paying attention to thrash metal at that time, but...
Which is great.
I love hair metal. Like you said, there was that five-year period where... It was Motley and Whitesnake and fucking...
And you know, that Motley Crue had a big influence too, because that the hedonistic tattoo scum, I mean, they were different than people you see on the street. I mean, at least in suburbia, you know? I mean, if you live in LA, that scene was there and whatnot. But for me, that was almost untouchable. Just like Kiss, like that's a whole different level.
Right.
Of showmanship and musicianship and just this thing.
Being the entity.
Yeah.
Because Nikki Sixx was, when I first saw Too Fast for Love and I looked on the back and there's the picture of the four of them and I'm looking at Nikki Sixx and then Mick Mars and Tommy Lee. And it always caught me that Vince Neil was the only one who really had a normal sounding kind of name. They were all kind of, and they looked monster, and they had the black, and it was just outrageous. And that's what I loved about it, was outrageous.
Oh, absolutely. You know, that's when Mick was still,
you
know, doing blood and
that was
the pentagrams. And like, whoa, that's crazy. But they had a big influence on me too. So very early on, like the theatrics of it is what really drew me in, you know, like they're like superheroes to me. You know, and they, and that shit still is. You know, I still go see Kiss, and it's like seeing superheroes, man. You know, I appreciate the phase of music and the era of music where, like, you know, dudes like you and me just get up there and, hey, man, we're just like the guys in the audience. The whole grunge thing, I appreciate that, but that's not what rock and roll is about for me. You know, there is a there's a level of separation between the fans and. And the musician, you know what I mean? And that's the entertainment factor. You know, I don't go to a show to be like we talked beforehand, you know, to hear your political views or, you know.
In between songs.
Yeah, and hear you bitching about life, man. Like, fuck, I'm here to forget about stuff and I'm here to have a good time.
You know? I don't care to hear about your, you know, who you hate politically or whatever, and you're going to say, I can't stand that. Entertain me. Talk about the crowd and how much fun they're having instead of that shit.
And that's where the glam rock scene was so great, because it was like a fucking party, right? I mean,
such a party.
These people were out of their fucking minds, but, you know, I mean, it was. That's what it was about. Let's celebrate. Let's, you know, let's drink, fuck,
and
do
there
drugs.
Was girls.
And
there was girls.
There was girls. Because that's not a small part of it.
and there was girls because we'd find ourselves going to, in the Bay Area, there wasn't as many hair metal bands, but there was.
That's where the chicks were.
But there was Vane shows, and there was Jet Boy shows.
Yeah, yeah.
And we all the heavy guys would we go there because why? Because this is the biggest joke in the world. What has 2,000 feet and two tits? An Exodus concert. Basically, that's what I've heard for. I didn't make that up. That's what I was told forever, and that's a joke that we've had forever. You know, we're a little bit more violent and brutal, so they're not saying you women. There's many of you that I've met. There's many of my friends, and they're thrashers, and they love Exodus, and I get you. But predominantly, especially when it started,
dude,
I was like, dude, there's like five chicks out there. It's like, what do you mean? This show's sold out. Yeah, it's sold out, and there's five girls out there that we'd go to, you know, I'd go see Y&T or Motley Crue in the Bay Area, and it'd be like,
and the ratio was highly different.
Oh my God, the ratio was a whole other ratio. You know what I mean? It was just a ratio. Oh my God. It was like that. It's like, you know.
God.
Yeah, yeah. You like the band? Yeah, they're okay. I like what's here though, you know.
Totally.
I can go there and get drunk and just, yeah.
That was a big part.
You play in a band? I sure do. You know. And
yeah.
I'll play that thrash metal, you know, speed metal. Y'all play speed metal?
Yeah.
We play speed metal. So that's your now you're transitioning.
Yeah. And you know, I'll never forget the one day, man. I was out with my mom. We were at a Taco Bell in Concord, right? And what shirt? I think I had an Alistair Fiend shirt on, right? Because I was sporting my colors, and I walked past this dude, and he looked at me, and he was like, poser.
I love that.
And I was
it
like,
it changed so quick.
Yeah, and I was like, whoa. Wow. You know, and that was a first, I mean, that's like, you know, that really stuck with me, obviously, because I'm bringing it up on this show fucking 40 years later, right?
Poser.
But man, that was the era too,
didn't
right?
Did you see Paul Bailoff last night? He called me a poser. I know, dude.
So, you know, outside of that, when I started taking the lessons though, I started playing with a different caliber of musician, you know, and, Queensryche started coming up big, and there was a band that I still love, Crimson Glory out of Florida. And dude, that
the Silver Masks.
The Transcendence album was like, whoa. The melodies, the harmonics, the syncopation of things, you know, was just mind-blowing for me. So we kind of went in that era, and I ended up with these older guys. And a guy out of Clayton, who was my age, went to Clayton Valley. Pat Rizak, and this dude was just, he's one of those guys that can pick up any instrument and completely play it proficient. You know what I mean?
In just a like, month time, he's like, did you just start playing that?
And that's when the sweeps were big, you know, Cacophony, Racer X,
yeah, sure.
And, you know, we love doing Scarified you know, which was pretty trippy for a couple 16-year-old kids. So we started doing that thing, and that was that band was actually named after a Fates Warning song called Silent Cry.
Silent Cry.
And we found this singer, Jay, that could sing falsetto. You know, we went out to Sacramento, recorded this demo, and...
What year?
This was 1990. And, you know, so that's when I really kind of got in the thick of it, you know, outside of it.
Because you're about ready to hit the big time here in about a year or so, right?
Yeah, man. And that was
at least
like
we thought, right?
Yeah, totally.
Isn't that great? Oh,
fuck, dude. You're like, yeah, I'm grabbing on.
Wait a minute.
It's like that game. It's like that game Pitfall, right?
Yeah, totally. It's totally like that, you know.
But it was amazing because here I was, you know, because there wasn't a lot of that around me, you know. Again, still at that time, I was one of a handful of people, you know, and most of the guys that were like me hit the field at lunch and on break and smoked weed. And that wasn't my scene, man. You know,
God, that was my scene.
You know, wallabies and feathers with roach clips and, you know.
I didn't have wallabies and feathers, but I did like the smoking weed part out of it. That was definitely a big part of my, I still see.
You know, so that really wasn't my scene, which, you know, I mean, I made up for it later. You know, I had a lot of catch up to do.
As long as you caught up.
Yeah. I did more than catch up.
What gigs did you play with that band? Did you play any of the Berkeley Keystones or did you do any of the
No, actually that match? One was that fizzled very fast, unfortunately. But we did manage to play My High School Again. And that was another one of those experiences, you know what I mean? We weren't
You we played the quad at lunch?
You know, no, but I love that picture of you with the hat.
With the head.
Fucking, that is fantastic, dude.
We played the quad at once.
That's so great.
Filthy.
But that's a great thing. Like, bands like Death Angel did that at Clayton Valley, you know what I mean? Right. That's what you did.
Yeah, you played high schools.
So. We did play the quad at our school, like our eighth grade, like graduation party. You know, my buddy and I set up and we jammed and, you know, we're like all the rage, blah, blah, blah. But... so we did this show again, you know, with lights and, you know, we had the big hair at that point, you know, and it was about the billowy shirts. You remember the big unbuttoned shirts and the vest the tight black pants. And it was kind of glam. It was kind of theatrical. Totally. Far, so you could see whatever little strands of chest hair were there.
One or two. I think I still have one or two.
So, we did that. It was a great deal, but, that one fizzled out too, you know? And I just trugged along, man. So it looks like we're
going to take a break. That's what we're going to do. We're actually, it's getting hot inside the vault here.